try this again. About we?
Here we go.
Sing the wondrous love of Jesus. Sing his mercy and his grace. In the mansion bright and blessed, he'll prepare for us a place. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory.
Encouraging song that is, when we will be totally and completely unified at the throne of Jesus Christ, hallelujah, in heaven, what a great day that will be. That motivates me, hallelujah, to be ready to be caught up together with him in the clouds, amen. You may be seated. It's such a delight to have you here with us this morning at Oak Orchard Assembly of God. We thank you as we gather together in the name of Jesus, for where two or three are gathered together in his name, he said, I would be there in your midst. God, we thank you and we ask you to fill this place with your glory today. Fill this place with your spirit, I pray, in Jesus' name. May everything that is said and done give glory to your name, in your strong and mighty name. And everyone said, amen, amen and amen. Hallelujah. Just going to share a couple of announcements with you. Diane, you just put this on here. Just share that. There's posters around the auditorium.
You will see the Joy Women's Conference is coming in the beginning of November. There are handouts if you're a woman. Hey, sorry, men. You know, you can make it possible for your wife, your daughter, your sister, whoever, to attend this conference. It's the first time in 2 years we're able to do this in person. It's going to be wonderful. The description of the whole thing is here. The sign-up is out there. The cost, whatever you need to know. If there's any information that you don't find in this handout, please see me, and I will try to answer those questions. Please prayerfully consider attending. This is a wonderful time of fellowship with other women in a wonderful atmosphere, praise and worship and ministry. If you've never heard Evelyn Klingler, we had 3 years ago had her as a speaker. She's coming back. Phenomenal. She is just amazing. So if you, who was at the conference with me when Evelyn was there? I know there were Diana, I'm sure Vicky was, Ingersoll. Donna was there. Is she not phenomenal? She is phenomenal. And it's a wonderful time in the Lord. So prayerfully consider. and see me if you have any questions.
Speaking of women, let's switch to men. This Thursday at Alabama Full Gospel on Route 63 going out of Medina, you all know where that is, we are having our men's dinner. And I will be speaking, a brief speaking, but we get together, we fellowship together with the men at Alabama Full Gospel. So men, you're all invited. This is 6 p.m. this Thursday at Alabama Full Gospel, a men's dinner. And if you're going to come, let me know, because I just need to let them know how many of our guys are coming so that they have plenty of food. And it's been my experience that they've always had plenty of food. And so that's a great, great time. Next Sunday, family night opens up again. Hallelujah. 6 p.m. Our adult praise, prayer, and share. We're focusing on worship in our adult praise, prayer, and share. We're allowing the Holy Spirit to work in our hearts and do a work in our hearts that only the Holy Spirit can through worship. We'll be sharing poignant scriptures. Hallelujah. And we're just going to let go and let God do what he wants Sunday nights in our adult praise, prayer, and share. And then we also have our Bible Kids Club, and we also have our youth group, and they're all opening next Sunday night at 6 p.m. Be there. Don't miss it. God has something special for you on Sunday nights here at Oak Orchard Assembly of God Church. Of course, this Wednesday, our prayer and Bible study, that's at 7 p.m. This past Wednesday, we had Leslie Latona, one of our great missionaries to Colombia. She did a wonderful job in sharing the word and in sharing the mission that she is on, and we just pray that God will continue to bless her. Other announcements are in your bulletin, and also there are prayer requests in there as well. But on Monday, September 13th, that's tomorrow, is Mike Hodgins' 31st anniversary of receiving his transplanted heart. Now, we're believing that Mike Hodgins is going to set records for a transplant surgery. Hallelujah. And he's well on his way. Hallelujah. Praise God. Thank you for Mike, and continue to keep him in your prayers. I am delighted this morning to bring to the platform to just give you a greeting all the way from Germany, where he is stationed as an army chaplain, Michael Scholes. Mike, come on up. He's here with his son, Liam. Well, he came into my office this morning, about fell over, you know, because it was just such a wonderful surprise. Mike, just give us a...
Amen. I need a hug. Thank you. Yeah. Praise the Lord. Good morning, church. So, I mean, it's a small town, but if you don't know me, yes, my name is Mike Scholes. I'm currently stationed in Ansbach, Germany, with the 1-3 Attack Battalion, which makes me the attack chaplain. Doesn't that sound amazing? I know. It sounds super cool. So, I just want to share with you real quick, thank you for all your prayers. I was baptized in this church. Pastor Thurber discipled me when I became a Christian at the age of 21. And never think that the fruits of your labor go unwarranted in the kingdom of God. They absolutely do. And I want to encourage you with this one thing. The biggest thing people ask me as an army chaplain is always, it's always about compromise. Like, oh, you can't pray in Jesus' name. It's a crock of garbage.
Yeah, amen.
Sorry, the army says bad words, and they get in my brain sometimes. Don't worry, I don't say them. You know, it's all sanctified up here. I know none of you ever think bad words. It's fine. Wait till you get on the highway. So, but it's not true, right? So as an Army chaplain, and I've been in the Army for 16 years, but I've only been a chaplain for just over six. But I've seen an insane amount of miracles, God doing crazy wonders. Every counseling appointment I have, 98% of them I call a joint counseling because the Holy Spirit's there with me. Giving prophetic words, seeing lots of healings. You don't have to compromise anything. And it's the greatest thing, because what soldiers need most of all is a real Jesus.
Amen.
And I think that's not only true of soldiers, I think it's true of the world around you.
Amen.
I think the mistake of the church is that we think that the Holy Spirit is confined to our Pentecostal sanctuary. But the truth is, Pentecost didn't happen in the upper room. Pentecost happened outside. They got filled with the Holy Spirit, and they left the upper room, and they used the signs and wonders to win people to Christ. And people always look at me, and they're like, that's crazy. I can bend my knee that way, or how'd you know about that dream, or whatever the case is, right? And I tell them the same thing I'm going to tell you. In Ephesians 5, it says that Elijah was a man just like us, with a nature like ours. Doesn't say Elijah was a man just like the pastor or the apostle or the prophet or the evangelist or the teacher or the office is. It says Elijah was a man with a nature like ours, all of ours. I don't do those supernatural things because there's a cross on my chest or because I'm a captain or because I'm ordained by the Assemblies of God or because Dan Thurber pastored me, although there's probably some good anointing there. Ready? All right, boom. But it's because of my nature as a Christian. And if Elijah says you're a man, his nature is a man like ours, you, every one of you, has the same ability. And the problem is you just don't know who you are in Christ. And I want to encourage you. I came from Ansbach, Germany. I got in last night at about 9 o'clock, and I walked into my dad's house. Well, it's my grandmother's house, right? She passed away. We're here for the funeral. But I walked into her house, and the first thing is I walked to the fridge, and I got myself a drink. Why? Because I know who I am in my father's house. This world is your father's house. When you walk out there, walk in the power. It just takes a little risk. So the next time you see a sick person, don't say, oh, come to my church so my pastor can anoint you with oil and heal you. No, no, no. You say, let me pray for you because God's will is to heal. You are our partaker of the divine nature. And I know we all like to say, we're all sinners saved by grace. That's also not true. You were a sinner. That phrase in the Bible is past tense. You're a saint now. If you believe you're a sinner, you will sin by faith. You're a saint. You walk in the power of God. And that which you sense right now inside of you, that's the Spirit. That's the anointing of God resting on the place. That's why the atmosphere just got thicker. That's why you're like, wow, it feels heavy, but I feel so light. It's the manifest presence of God. It's the anointing of God. It's not meant to rest on me, your pastor. It's meant to rest on the church. You know what his job is? To equip the saints to do the work of the ministry. You're the workers. Do some great work for God. Thank you so much. I love you all.
Thank you, Pastor. You.
Amen. Hallelujah. Praise God. Thank you, Michael. Thank you, Michael. And we will continue to pray for you and your family in Germany. So there's still men and women out there all over the world like Michael. And I asked him about the chaplaincy programs and the different services and stuff like that. And they're about at 88% capacity. But what he said, every individual chaplain, of course, is different. But we have a chaplain here that does not compromise the gospel in any way, shape, or fashion in his ministry. And whatever God tells us to do, when he says, let's get going, and we say, okay, God, let's roll, you do it with all your might as unto the Lord in the power of the Holy Spirit, and we will see fruit for the kingdom of God. So thank you so much, Michael. Thank you so much for who you are and what you do. Our scripture this morning, our memorization scripture for this week, comes from John 14:26. And if you pull it out of your bulletin, and let's read it together. And this is our scripture memory for this week. It's on the screen this morning. Let's say it together. But the Comforter, which is the Holy Ghost, whom the Father will send in my name, he shall teach you all things and bring all things to your remembrance, whatsoever I have said to you. The Holy Spirit, the Spirit of truth that leads us into all truth, as we are the body of Christ serving God in the capacity that he has given us, the Holy Spirit will be with you. He will give you the knowledge that you need. He will bring to your remembrance the scripture that you need in that exact moment of ministry. He will not fail you if you keep your ear in tune to him. Memorize this scripture so the devil cannot deceive you from the truth. The Holy Ghost will be with you in all things in your ministry. So memorize that this week. It's so important to memorize the Word of God. Amen? And now for another testimony. Russell, you come up and give your testimony this morning. No. Russell already told me. He said, I'll be brief.
Mike, great to see you. Love you. Known you since you were a little kid. Great to see you. But I'm just staying up here, and I am going to be short. And I am 6'1", but not really. I'm not really. You're short, exactly. But no, I thank the Lord that I'm able to stand up here and thank him for the answer of prayers. And I thank you for all praying for me, because I went to the cancer doctor. And I hope, and I praise the Lord, that maybe I'll never have to go see the cancer doctor again. Amen. But I will. But everything came out good. I don't have to have no chemo, no radiation. Hallelujah. So I give God the glory. Amen. Thank you.
Glory to God. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Are you disappointed? Mind, Dave Wheeler, you can't have it both ways. Praise God. It's good to rejoice with those that rejoice. We also mourn with those that mourn. And this weekend, yesterday, marked the 20th anniversary of the assault on our nation. And it was more than an assault on our nation. It was an assault on our Christian faith as well. But we, today, are going to stand in remembrance of what happened on that day. But we're looking forward to what God is doing and what he is going to continue to do. Because one thing I want to say right now, God has it in control. Amen. I know we got a lot of things going on this morning, so bear with us. But today, we want to receive into the membership of Oak Orchard Assembly of God 8 new members. And so I would like these people to come to the platform this morning, and we're going to receive you into the fellowship of Oak Orchard Assembly of God Church. They are Rebecca Austin, Rebecca Gates, Daniel Ingersoll, Randy Ingersoll, Avelina Lynn Livingston, Cecil Livingston, Darylyn Songer, and Hannah Songer. Would you please come to the platform? And if I could ask our board members that are here this morning, if you would also join us on the platform, because you will be extending the right hand of fellowship. Good morning. Good morning. Hallelujah. You know, when we commit ourselves and when we align ourselves with a local assembly, we are saying that we and all of these have gone through the fundamentals of faith class. I believe you went through the fundamentals of faith class, Michael. And we learned the 16 fundamentals of faith of the Assemblies of God, all comes directly out of the Bible. And we've committed to believing in Jesus Christ as the Lord and Savior, the Son of God, and that we will follow after what God has commanded us to do as Christians. And the first qualification to be a member of Oak Orchard Assembly of God Church is to be a member of the church in the body of Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. But they have decided that they want to align themselves with this local fellowship. And we are so delighted that you have this morning. And I just want to get a commitment from you with an I do this morning. And as I share this, please answer I do after I'm done, and I will direct you right through it, okay? Do you, all of you candidates for membership who have already been approved by the board of this church, do you promise by the aid of the Holy Spirit to walk together in Christian love, strive for the advancement of this church for holiness and knowledge, promote its prosperity and spirituality, sustain its worship, doctrines, and discipline, and contribute cheerfully and regularly to the support of the ministry and activities of this church? If so, answer, I do. And do you promise to watch over one another in brotherly love, to remember each other in prayer, to aid each other in distress and sickness, to be courteous and forgiving to one another, even as God, for Christ's sake, has forgiven you? If so, answer, I do. You know, it's important that we align ourselves, that we bring ourselves under the discipline and love of the church, because when we make ourselves accountable to God and accountable to one another, we will overcome anything that this world has to try to draw us away from God. And so the fellowship in which we receive you into today is very important, and we're happy that you're moving into that. I would like to pray right now, and then after we pray, we were going to give you the right hand of fellowship, all right? So all of us, would we pray together in receiving these new members? Father God, we thank you that we can be a member of the body of Jesus Christ, because Jesus, you shed your blood on the cross of Calvary. You took the penalty of sin and death upon yourself. You became sin. One that knew no sin became sin so that we might be set free. We thank you for that freedom. And I thank you, Lord, for these eight this morning that have decided to align themselves here at Oak Orchard Assembly of God Church. May they be a fruitful members of this body. Lord, may they share the gospel with the way that they live their lives as they've been called out to be your servants. We receive them now in the name of Jesus Christ as part of the membership here at Oak Orchard Assembly of God Church. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Now I'm going to pass out these certificates, and then the board will come behind me and will offer you the right hand of fellowship. As they return to their seats. I'm so glad I'm a part of the family of God. I've been washed in the fountain, cleansed by his blood, joined heirs with Jesus as we travel this side. For I'm part of the family of God. Amen. Hallelujah. Say praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Almighty God, we thank you for being in this house today. And I pray, Lord God, that your Holy Spirit might flow into this place. I pray that we might decrease, that you might increase. I pray for the anointing of the Spirit to be on this worship time. Lord, we bring it to you. We didn't come, Lord, to take. We came to give what you are worthy of all. Our praise and all glory goes to you in this place today. Lord Jesus, we raise up all of those that need a healing touch today. You are the healer. By your stripes we are healed. We pray, Lord, that your healing virtue would flow over each one in Jesus' name. Lord Jesus, those that need reconciliation in their life, a restoration, Lord. Holy Spirit, do that surgery in our hearts, Lord, that changes us and transforms us. Oh God, I pray in the name of Jesus, and we plead the blood of Jesus over each one in this congregation this morning, that any of the works of the devil would be null and void and leave this place in Jesus' name, that God, only you will be seen this morning. We lift you up, we raise you up, and now we give you praise and we give you thanks in all things. And everyone said, amen and amen. Let's worship in spirit and in truth. Hallelujah.
Bless the name of Jesus. Praise the name of Jesus. Sing unto the King of Israel. Bless the name of Jesus. Praise the name of Jesus. Sing unto the King of Israel. Bless the name of Jesus.
Presence of the King. continue to play right now. Just worship him. Just praise him today. Thank him. Jesus, Jesus. Hallelujah. We praise your holy name, Lord God.
Just the presence of Jehovah, Jehovah God. All of these things disappear because he is God Almighty. If you need peace, the presence of Jehovah brings it.
Hallelujah.
If you have trouble, the presence of Jehovah makes them vanish. If you need a heart mended, it's the presence of God who heals the mends the broken heart. It's the presence of God, not anything we say or do. It's acknowledging his presence right here, right now. Hallelujah.
Just worship him now.
Jesus. Hallelujah.
In the presence.
Claim it right now.
Oh,
Goodness and grace, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Glory to Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Just thank Jesus. Appreciate him this morning. Thank him. Bless his name. Count your blessings. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus, for salvation.
Thank you, Jesus, for your love. Thank you, Jesus, for your mercy. Thank you, Jesus, for restoration. Thank you, Jesus, for reconciliation. Thank you, Lord, that you know all things about my life. Thank you, Jesus, that you have a plan for my life. Thank you, Jesus, that you lead me into all truth. Thank you, Jesus, that you love me with an undying love. Thank you, Lord, that your mercy endures forever. Oh, thank you, Jesus, for your Holy Spirit. Thank you, Lord God, for yourself, the great I am, the beginning and the end, the Alpha and Omega, the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. We worship you and we honor you, God. We put you first in our life. We give you praise and we give you thanks because you are all that we need. You sustain us. You take care of us. You provide for us. You give us eternal life. There's nothing that we need that you do not provide. Thank you, Jesus. I need He's all I need. Jesus is all I need. Yes, Jesus. Oh, He's all I need. He's all I need. Jesus is all I need. Yes, hallelujah, hallelujah. He answers prayer. Yes, He does. He answers prayer. My Jesus, He answers prayer. Yes, He does. Oh, He answers prayer. He answers prayer. My Jesus, He answers prayer. How many can say amen to that this morning? Hallelujah. How many know that the answer isn't always the answer that you want, but it's always the right answer? He has the right answer for you this morning. Hallelujah. You may be seated. The children would join me on the platform here as we pray for you as you go to Children's Church and as the ushers wait upon us for our morning tithes and offerings as we give cheerfully unto the Lord because of His provision in our lives. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Glory to God. Everybody back to school and saying, yay, I'm back to school. Hallelujah. Praise God. Yeah, I know they all enjoy school, love being in school. Let's pray. Father God, we thank you for the blessing of our children. We thank you for your heritage. I pray that you would be with them as they go to Children's Church this morning, that they might know the love and peace that Jesus, you can bring into their young lives. May they choose you even at these young ages, Lord God. May they know you. Lord God, we thank you for you are Jehovah Jireh, our provider. We thank you that we can give, Lord, to you cheerfully this morning. And we do just that, not grudgingly, but with a cheerful heart. Because, God, you do all things well. And we as a church will commit, Lord God, to use these funds in a stewardship-like manner for the kingdom of God. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. God bless you. Hallelujah. Glory to God. We're going to sing this song before we go into the message this morning. It's entitled, All Hail King Jesus. And we want to give God praise and thanks for our most recent knee replacement recipients. Russ Eckham is doing fantastic in his knee replacement. Dave Revere is home and he is doing his, recovery and rehab that you're supposed to do religiously. He's doing that. Sylvia said he's doing great, and so we're believing for his complete recovery this morning. Let's give God a praise offering, hallelujah, for these recent answers to prayer. Hallelujah. And, of course, for Russell's answer to prayer, I see Ron and Karen Matuzak have come in this morning. God bless you. You're in our prayers every day. We're believing that God is going to restore you to full health, Ron Matuzak. Hallelujah. It might look impossible in the world's eyes, but with God, all things are possible. So let's sing it this morning. All hail King Jesus. All hail Emmanuel.
All hail King
Jesus. All hail Emmanuel.
you seated. I was delighted in my heart when I saw Margot and Paul Schooner come into church this morning. As you know, she had another battle with the floor and her head and her finger, but she is recovered, and we thank God that you're in your spot this morning, right where you belong. So Paul and Margot, it's so good to see you. And Raj and Kay Thurber, I know that it's a struggle for you to get out here to church, but you know that it's right, that if you can get in church, we need to be in church. We need to be in church because we are not to forget the assembling of ourselves together. Because what it does when we assemble ourselves together, even though it takes getting to church a priority, and sometimes it's a struggle to get here, when you come, you encourage the entire body of Jesus Christ to hang in there, to serve Jesus. You're not alone. You're praying for them. We're all together in this under the banner of Jesus Christ, and we're going to overcome in this chaotic world. Hallelujah. My God is an overcomer. Jesus himself in John chapter 16 and verse 31 said, Jesus answered to them, "Do you now believe? Listen, the hour is coming. Yes, it has now come that you will be scattered, each to his own home, and will leave me alone. Yet I am not alone." This is Jesus speaking, "for the Father is with me. Now I have told you these things so that in me you may have peace." Jesus wants you to have peace. Now, this is irregardless of what's going on in the world. The chaos, the walk away from God, people denying Christ, Islamic extremists attacking our country. Through all of that, Jesus wants you to have peace. "For in the world you will have tribulation." Do you believe Jesus this morning? Well, that's kind of the bad news he brought to his disciples, and he brings to us this morning. In this world, you will have tribulation, but be of good cheer. Be of good cheer because I have overcome the world. So I want to be of good cheer this morning. So I want to see a smile on your face this morning. Everybody look at me and smile. Let me see those smiles. You know what, Addie? Or Bob, push up the house lights. Okay, now I can see. All right, now let me see them smiles. Jesus said, "Be of good cheer." We're remembering what happened 20 years ago when those terrorists attacked those trade centers, the Pentagon. And hallelujah, that fourth plane, we're going to talk about that this morning, went down in a field in Shanksville, Pennsylvania. But Jesus said, "You will have tribulation, but be of good cheer." So going into this message, I want you to be of good cheer. I want you to know that God's got it in control. I want you to know that the Holy Spirit is going to bring opportunities in your life if you will open yourself up to being a minister of the gospel wherever you are. This is not just a job for pastors and evangelists and chaplains. Hallelujah. It's a job for each and every one of us that we may be called upon to say, "Are you ready? Well, then let's roll." Are you ready? Well, then let's roll. Now, that iconic line that came from Todd Beamer aboard United Flight 93, which they believe that fourth plane on September 11th was headed for our capital. And as if you recall, and if you know all of this story, that's perfectly okay, but I want to reiterate it this morning because of how God used a group of people that got united and called upon Jesus to do an extraordinary, courageous act so that others might be saved. You know, one, Jesus Christ knew that that was the act that he was going to have to do. He was going to have to give his life. He wasn't looking for his own comfort, even though he was tempted in all points like we are, even though he felt the anguish in the Garden of Gethsemane when he said, "If it's possible, let this cup pass from me, but not my will, but thine be done," to his heavenly Father. that he willingly went through and gave his life so that you and I could be of good cheer this morning. Why? Because Jesus overcomes the world. Can I get an amen? So Todd Beamer, in a dispatch, when he called this dispatcher, her name was Lisa Jefferson. And at that call center is where he had quite a lengthy discussion on an airphone in the back of that airplane that was headed for the Capitol. It had been hijacked by these hijackers that had taken control of the cockpit, had killed at least one of the stewardesses or flight attendants, and they weren't sure, Todd Beamer wasn't sure what had happened to the pilots, but they were under control. Were they dead? We don't know. But what we do know is that people on that flight, there was 33 people and 7 flight attendants, 40 in all, that died that day in that plane. And to set this up, this Todd Beamer, can you say Todd Beamer? Do you know who I'm talking about? He was this guy that, by the way, he attended Wheaton College. Wheaton is a liberal arts evangelical college. Todd Beamer was a good Christian, along with his wife. Good Christians, found himself on this plane, which was originally headed for San Francisco, had gotten turned around, and was headed for our nation's capital. This Lisa Jefferson, the dispatcher, who took Todd Beamer's famous call from Flight 93, has told reporters that she and Todd's wife were like girlfriends in the wake of the attacks, offering support to each other. And in the years since Todd's death, a post office and a high school have been named after him. And Todd's story should always be remembered and honored. Wheaton College Dean Steve Ivester said in a campus publication, "I think the bas relief moves each rising generation of students that walk the halls of the Beamer Center." The Beamer Center is the hall that is on the college campus, the Union Hall, if you will, the student center that was named after Todd Beamer. And in this is this etching, this bas relief that has a picture of Todd and his son walking down a path. And on the bottom of that, it said, "Let's roll." Now, this "let's roll" is a call to action. And I believe God is calling us in this day and age, Christians, in a call to action. No longer can we just sit down and do nothing, but Christians in the United States of America need to stand up and serve Jesus and work in the power of the Holy Ghost. Amen. And so when Jesus says, "Are you ready? Let's roll," we roll. We roll. At the student center, the etching of Beamer shows him walking in the distance, holding hands of his sons. "Let's roll" is engraved underneath, and Jefferson has said, "Beamer said the Lord's Prayer and the 23rd Psalm before he spoke those now famous words of 'Let's roll.'" He was only 32 years old. And he, along with those 33 others, had hatched a plan. And they knew, because others were on the phone and on their cell phones and found out what was going on with the World Trade Centers and that those buildings had been struck. So they knew that these hijackers were not just a normal hijacking and taking them to some other airport, but that that plane was destined for some place to do destruction as well. And so Todd Beamer and those 33 passengers got together, hatched a plan how they were going to storm the cockpit, take control of that airplane, and set it down in a field where it couldn't hurt anybody at all. These are not trained pilots. The ones that were in the cockpit, the terrorists, they were trained pilots, and they were trained right here in the United States of America. How sad is that to think? That we have people, and I believe we still have people today in the United States of America that wish to do our country harm, that are trying to infiltrate and look normal in society so that they can do destruction to our... But remember, when we're in this world, we're going to have trouble. But be of good cheer, because who's the overcomer? Jesus is the overcomer. And if he asks you to roll, we can roll in confidence with him. Hallelujah. That decision that that crew made to storm the cockpit, and some would say, well, they had nothing to lose. Okay, maybe that's true. Maybe they were thinking, there's nothing that we can do to save our lives. Where would you be in that situation? And where would you be in that situation without God to call upon? Where would you be in that situation if you didn't know that your future was eternal life with Jesus Christ? You know, knowing who you are in Jesus Christ and what you have in store for your future makes all of the difference in how you respond to things in this world today. Amen? If you don't know what your future is, you can't properly respond to an activity here in this earth, especially one where you're looking death in the eye. So Todd Beamer, talking to the dispatcher before they rolled, said, would you do one thing with me? Would you pray the Lord's Prayer with me and recite the 23rd Psalm? So let's say the Lord's Prayer together today. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. And yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Hallelujah. Now that is getting them psyched up to do what they have to do. They could have cowered in the back of that plane and done nothing and allow those terrorists to fly that plane into the Capitol or the White House. They believe it was the Capitol where it was headed to do the most damage, to kill the most people. But they didn't, because they got together and they said, in the power of Jesus Christ, we're going to roll on this one. And God, you go with us. Todd said to Lisa Jefferson, right, she heard it. She goes, God help us. Jesus help us. They that call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Help us, O God. And then in those iconic words, after they said, all the glory goes to Almighty God, all the power is his, help us, Jesus. Turned to those on the plane, Todd Beamer, said, are you ready? Be of good cheer, because my God is an overcomer. Let's roll. And that was the last. And they rolled, they stormed the cockpit, and took that plane 538 miles per hour directly into a field in Shanksville, Pennsylvania, 20 years ago. And we don't know how many lives were saved because of that act. Some say it could have been thousands. But I know that when God puts within the heart of man those that will trust in him, put their faith in him, that all things are possible because of the Jesus that dwells within us, to overcome the fear and to have the courage to do things we never thought possible in our lives. I'm talking about you this morning. I'm talking about me. On whatever scale it is in our life, if we turn to Jesus, if we let him be our guide, we let him be the one that controls our life, we listen to the voice of the Holy Spirit and then respond to that Holy Spirit, God has already prepared the way. And the victory is going to be won. You'd say, was victory won there in that circumstance? Where's Todd Beamer today? He's in heaven. He's good. He's good. His wife is good, preaching the gospel of Jesus Christ. sharing the testimony of her husbands and those 33 other that had Christ. By the way, do you think every single passenger on that plane turned to God at that time? You better believe it. You better believe it. There's no atheist in the foxhole. That's what they say. When you're looking death in the eye, all of a sudden, that faith that's within you to find your Creator, you can't save your life. You better hope that there's a God that can save your life and give you eternal life. And we turn to that. That's why God put that measure of faith in us. We can all know Him. We can all be saved. And they that call upon the Lord shall be saved. Hallelujah. So God gave them the courage to do what they had to do on that day. Hallelujah. So where does that bring us in 2021? Well, America, number one, needs to turn back to God. If we remember all of these tragic situations and don't do anything to help the cause of Jesus Christ, Christians, I'm talking to you, then people have died in vain. People have not learned the lessons of history. One of the lessons of history we know is that the terrorists, the people that want to destroy Jesus and all of His believers, are still out there. There's still a jihadist out there that wants to take you out. But America and the church need to turn back to God. Can I get an amen? Jason Yates, which is the CEO of My Faith Votes, which is a nonpartisan movement that motivates, equips, and activates Christians in America to vote in every election, transforming our communities and influencing our nation with biblical truth. And by partnering with the national faith leaders, My Faith Votes provides resources to help Christians to pray, think, and act to create an America where God is honored in the public square. And when you're honoring God in the public squares and nowadays, you're going to find trouble. You're going to find persecution. You're going to find those that come against you. But God is calling us, citizens of the United States of America, to come back to God. Can I get an amen? Amen. This year not only marks 20 years since that horrific terrorist attacks in New York City and on the Pentagon and on that fourth plane, it also reminds us that that same evil, and it's exactly that, it is evil that invaded the United States of 2001, still exists today. You know, I think of the story of Joseph, and I think how his brothers had wanted to do evil against him. They left him for dead, and he was picked up, and he was taken to Pharaoh's house, and things were not looking good for Joseph. But every moment of Joseph's life, God called upon him, Joseph, you just keep following me. You just keep following the dreams that I have given you. You just keep doing what I've called you to do. You be ready, and you roll when it's time to roll, and I'll take care of the rest. And Joseph always rolled every time God told him to roll. Even though he was in prison, whatever he did it with all of his might as unto the Lord. Keep on keeping on. Do whatever God calls you to do, as unto the Lord, because He's got a plan, and He had a plan to deliver the Israelites and the Egyptians through all of the times of drought, and they were delivered. Thousands of people's lives were saved through that famine, and of course you know the end of the story. But the brothers, who had meant evil for their brother Joseph, were terrified at the end of his life that Joseph was going to meet out judgment upon them because of the evil that they perpetrated in his life. But Joseph, hallelujah, and I want to take you to the scripture in Genesis chapter 50, 19:21. Joseph said to his brothers, "Do not be afraid, for am I in the place of God? But as for you, you meant evil against me, but God meant it for good in order to bring it about, as in this day, to save many people's lives." God can take a terrible terrorist act like He did on 2001, September 11th, on that plane headed for the Capitol. He took that situation and he rolled people into action so that thousands of people could be saved. Hallelujah. The same thing with Joseph. He rolled into action. He was obedient to God, and you know the rest of the story. He was elevated to be the second over all of the kingdom. He took care of all the 7 years of famine and all the 7 years of plenty, made up storehouses, saved his family's life. But he wanted his brothers to know, yeah, you wanted to do evil against me, and I'm not going to hold that against you, because God can take the evil that you meant against me, and he can turn it to good, and he did turn it to good. And so they didn't fear their brother. Let this scripture in Joseph's life be a testimony to us as well. The devil's power is limited by the power of Almighty God. Amen? The devil can't do anything that is not allowed by God. And God can use all of those things that he means for evil, and he can turn them to good. And I thank God for that this morning. That devil, the thief, did not come except to steal. He wants to kill, and he wants to destroy. But Jesus said, I have come that they may have life, and that they may have life more abundantly. In recent weeks, and this comes as a quote from Jason Yakes from My Faith Votes, we've seen images of people clinging to the wing of a U.S. military aircraft, leaving Hamad Karzai International Airport in Kabul, grasping for their chance to escape the Taliban as aircraft lifted off the ground. We've seen mothers passing their babies over barbed wire fences into the hands of American military personnel, hoping for nothing more than the safety of their children. These heartbreaking scenes make the 20th anniversary of September 11th even more painful. Today, it is vital that we reflect and learn from the events followed on the attacks of September 11th, 2001. Hallelujah. But my God, hallelujah, he has it in control. He has overcome the world. He will overcome these terrorists. God's going to be glorified as the church stands up and begins to roll at God's commands. America needs God. In the wake of September 11th attacks, we mourn those who lost their loved ones, reached out to neighbors, extended grace and kindness towards others. We called evil what it is, and we renewed our resolve to protect freedom. But most of all, we turned our gaze upwards to Almighty God. You remember the days after those attacks, there were politicians on both sides of the aisle singing on the Capitol, God bless America. Oh God, unite us again under the banner of Jesus Christ. May this country be a country that says we are one nation under God. In God we trust. Hallelujah. 2 days after the attack, President George W. Bush called for a national day of prayer and remembrance to be observed on September 14th. And he said in part, Scripture says, blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted. President Bush said, I call on every American family and family of America to observe a national day of prayer and remembrance. We will preserve through this national tragedy and personal loss. We will persevere. And in time, we will find healing and recovery. And in the face of all this evil, we remain strong and united, one nation under God. Where did that one nation under God go? It seems to be dissipating rapidly, does it not? But I call upon the Church of Jesus Christ this morning to be that one nation under God, to be that united force in the United States of America, to be that remnant that calls on the name of Jesus, to be a ready church, to be the church that God has called us to be, loving one another, serving our fellow man, serving God first, hallelujah, so that we can be ready, so that when God says, are you ready? And he says, let's roll, you will say, amen, let's go. I don't fear, because my destiny and my future is with Jesus in heaven. What can I fear that man can do to me? Man can't do anything to you. You are free in Jesus Christ this morning to do whatever God has called you to do. Now, and I continue to quote Jason, now it is far less common to see government officials encouraging us to seek the Lord. We live in a culture that is rapidly moving away from God, and Americans have taken the idea of separation of church and state much too far. And this is what My Faith Vote, why they exist. And this is a semi-commercial for My Faith Votes. But Christians in America must commit to praying for our nation and its leaders, thinking about the issues biblically, and then acting by bringing their faith to the public square and then to the voting booth. So number one, America needs to turn back to God. And then number two this morning, the freedoms that we hold dear in this country need to be protected. And the greatest way that we can protect those freedoms are in the voting booth. Our servicemen and women bravely answered the call to defend our freedom when our nation needed them in the aftermath of September 11th. Thousands made that ultimate sacrifice that they gave of their lives fighting against evil on behalf of the United States over the course of 20 years. And we remember the families of military and first responders who lost loved ones, and we are profoundly grateful for their sacrifice. Recent events in Afghanistan remind us that America's enemies are alive and well, and they are as eager as ever to see freedom fall and the great American experiments come to an end. We remember the 13 brave military members who gave their lives just a few weeks ago in an effort to rescue others in Afghanistan. Ronald Reagan was right that freedom must be protected by each generation, which is one reason we at My Faith Votes believe voting is so important. Our votes are the best defense against terrorism and tyranny. We have the tremendous opportunity to elect strong leaders who seek God's wisdom and honor biblical values. And the leaders we are elect are not only tasked with preserving freedom at home, but their influence also impacts the freedoms of people around the globe. And I pray that you would join me in praying that men and women, Christian men and women, that have a true transformative relationship with Jesus Christ would answer the call to get into politics in our country, to become leaders in our country, and to lead with the power of the Holy Spirit our country. Pray for that. When God raises them up, vote for them. Because America needs to turn back to God, and we need our freedoms protected. In the battle to defend freedom, there often comes the temptation to lose hope. And this is when we must remember the truths found in Scripture. As believers, we have a special responsibility to pray intensely and unceasingly for all of the vulnerable in Afghanistan whose fate now rests again in the hands of their oppressors. We pray people would call upon the name of the Lord and believe in Jesus Christ for their eternal life. Let us never, ever forget what happened on September 11th. But let us always never lose hope and look to Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith. 1 John 4 says, Beloved, verse 4, do not believe every spirit, but test the spirits whether they are of God, because many false prophets have gone out into the world. These terrorists, these people that don't believe that Jesus is the Messiah, there's many false prophets out in the world, and they even stand on their own God, and they do this jihadist movement, which is a religious battle against Christians. It's against Jesus. Make no mistake about it. These battles are against Jesus and Him being God and the Savior of the world. That's who it's against. Every spirit that confesses that Jesus Christ has come in the flesh is of God. And every spirit that does not confess that Jesus Christ has come in the flesh is not of God. And this is the spirit of Antichrist, which you have heard was coming and is now already in the world. The spirit of the Antichrist is in the world, and it is everywhere, and it's taken hold. But you, verse 4, are of God, little children, and have overcome them, those that are in the spirit of Antichrist, because he who is in you is greater than he who is in the world. You have Jesus indwelling in you by the Holy Spirit. He is in you, in your heart. That is the weapon that you have against the Antichrist. He doesn't have control over you, Christian, this morning. You can roll with confidence that Jesus is in you, and greater is he that's in you than he that is in the world. Can I get an amen? Hallelujah. You have been equipped by the Holy Spirit, hallelujah, to be in God's army. And we can, hallelujah, bring God back into this country by letting God back into our hearts and back into our church. And we can stand and we can be strong and we can be courageous and we can do great things through Jesus Christ who strengthens us. Hallelujah. That's exciting. I'm on God's team. I see George, he's got his Bills gear on this morning. Well, we know that the Bills home opener is today against the Pittsburgh Steelers, correct? We're on a Bills team, right? We're Bills fans. We want the Bills to win. But it's not guaranteed. It's not guaranteed. They might lose today. But be of good cheer. Those of you that are on the team, Jesus Christ. Those of you that wear the logo of Jesus Christ on your hearts. You don't lose. You overcome. Amen. Be of good cheer. The season's beginning. Let it start. I'm on God's team. I'm ready. I'm prepared. I've put God's word in my heart. I'm ready. The Holy Spirit has filled me, baptized me, empowered me to witness. I'm on the team. I'm going to excel because Jesus goes with me. Hallelujah. We're going to win. I'm of good cheer this morning. We're of good cheer for the Buffalo Bills. Until they lose, then we lose our joy. Don't let the devil take your joy thinking that you're going to be losing. That's a lie of the devil. He knows you're going to win. That's why he's so aggravated. He knows that his destiny is secured, and he's going to the pits of hell. But hell was not created for you and me. God is not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. But devil is going to go to hell. Hell was prepared for the devil and his angels. Amen? Not for you and me. We're overcomers. We are victors in Jesus. Let's roll. Let's get on Jesus' side. Let's get prayed up. Let's get baptized up. Let's believe. Let's be strong in the Lord. Let's take the truth of God's word. Let it be embedded in our hearts so when that devil who's roaming around like a roaring lion seeking whom he may devour doesn't get any lunches from us. He's not going to be devouring us. Because, you know, people that are filled with the Holy Ghost, it's a nasty, nasty, nasty taste in the devil's mouth. He can't be where the Holy Spirit is. They can't dwell the same house. The Spirit dwells in you. The devil does not. And if you've allowed a foothold of Satan to get into your life, if you've backslidden, if you have allowed the things of this world and the gods of this world to take priority in your life, and it happens, the deceiver is out there. Don't let it happen to you. Turn back, repent, say, I want to be on the right team. I want to be on Jesus' team. I want to be ready when Jesus says, let's roll. I'm going to be ready to roll. Why? Because greater is he who's in us than he that is in the world. They are of the world. Therefore, they speak as the world. And the world hears them. But we, hallelujah, are of God. He who knows God hears us. He who is not of God does not hear us. By this we know the spirit of truth and the spirit of error. This is how we can discern the spirits. This is how we know when the deceiver is out there deceiving, because the truth has set us free. Jesus leads us into all truth, and we've been set free, so we know that's of the devil. I reject it. Get thee behind me, Satan. This is the voice of God. I'm going to follow in the voice of God because he always leads me to victory. Hallelujah. 2 Timothy 1:7 says, for God has not given us a spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of a sound mind. When it came right down to it, when Todd Beamer had to make that decision, if they were going to take action, against those terrorists in the cockpit because of his security in Jesus Christ, the decision was easy. It wasn't hard. Saying let's roll for Todd and for us is a recipe for a helpful, purposeful life, a life of servanthood to God. Let's roll. Let's not shy away from what God has for us. Let's run into it. And I thank God for so many of the first responders on that day that ran into those buildings, giving no regard for their own life so that others might be saved. I thank God for our military, for over these past 20 years have kept us safe from others that would like to do destruction in our country. You need to be thankful for your military. You need to be thankful for our first responders and our police force. We need to be thankful for people like Michael, hallelujah, that are working on our behalf to keep us safe. Are you thankful? Say amen. Do you remember? Say amen. Are you on Jesus' team? Say amen. Do you know that you're an overcomer today? Do you know that your future is secure in heaven with Jesus Christ? Do you know that whatever man seems meant for evil for you, God can turn it to good? Do you know that all things work together for good to those that love God and are called according to his purpose? Do you know that you're on God's team and that we win? The victory has already been won. And where was the victory won? It was won on the cross of Calvary. It is finished. It's all over. Sin has been defeated. It has been destroyed. Hallelujah. I'm excited about Jesus this morning. I'm excited because I'm on his team. The Yankees have to take a back seat. How disappointing they have been to me. They go on a 13-game winning streak, and then Russell's back there. He's clapping because he's a Boston Red Sox fan. You see, when we put our faith in man and earthly things, they do bring us joy for a season. But they can't bring that inner joy that is everlasting and eternal. Only Jesus. Only Jesus. Only Jesus can fulfill us in that way. The joy of the Lord is our strength. And in this chaotic world, we can live as victors. It will call for some sacrifice on your life. It will call for you to be obedient to the voice of God. There will be tribulation in your life, but be of good cheer. Be of good cheer, because Jesus says, I have overcome the world. Let's bow our hearts together. Father God, we are so thankful that we serve a living God, a God that has created all things, a God that loves us with an enduring love. Even in our sin, you love us, Jesus. I thank you for that. I thank you for your mercy. I thank you for your grace, your unmerited favor. I thank you for the opportunity to know you. I thank you for the opportunity to have access to you, oh God. What an amazing thing it is that we have access to the Creator of the universe. Lord, I pray that none of us here in this place this morning would take for granted how mighty, awesome, powerful, loving, and merciful that you are, and that you have the keys of life and death in your hands, and that you have provided by your finished work on the cross of Calvary for each and every one of us to know salvation, to know you. And Lord God, we don't take that relationship for granted, but Lord God, we present our bodies as living sacrifices, which is our reasonable act of service and worship to you, Almighty God. I pray, Lord, that you, through your word, as we continue to memorize your word, to read your word, Lord, to be in your word every day and in prayer with you every day, communication with you every day. We decide for you, Jesus. You've already decided for us. You are near. You have not gone anywhere. When it looks like everything is in chaos, Jesus, you are the same yesterday, today, and forever. You have not changed. Lord, we know that you love us and that you will guide us, that you will lead us, that you will empower us. Lord, we open our hearts to you today. Lord, we open our minds to you. Lord, we want to be your servants here on this earth so that many, through our ministries, through our obedience, Lord God, might come to know you as their Lord and Savior. Lord, I pray for the salvation, Lord Jesus, of our family and our friends that don't know you, those that are in our sphere of influences, Lord God. I pray that we as soldiers in the army of the Lord, Lord, would stand and be ready, Lord God, to roll at any moment that you tell us to roll, Lord Jesus. I pray that we would be holy because you're a holy God. I pray, Lord Jesus, that we would worship you in spirit and in truth, and that you would have the preeminence in our life. Empower us now, Lord God, by your Holy Spirit. And I pray this in the precious name of Jesus Christ. And the army of the Lord said, amen and amen. Are you ready? Let's roll. Hallelujah. God bless you.